Hello, everybody, and welcome to the, I'd forgotten the exact number, it's six or seven at this point.
Seventh
Former People podcast, seventh issue, or something along those lines. So this issue, we did something a little bit different. So we had one of the big focuses of our attention be on an poetry chapbook. We did have our usual amount of interviews and submissions of various stripes. So, gentlemen, where do we want to start first? We've got a number of places we could do so in an interesting fashion.
Well, I was looking through what we have here, and it seems to me that I could almost see a theme this issue, but I wasn't sure if I was projecting onto it. But did you guys think that there was an accidental theme for this issue?
It was definitely accidental, but I'm not saying that it wasn't one. It may have just been my mood when I was picking the poetry this month.
Well, how would you describe your mood as you were picking poetry?
I was feeling a little bit more political and flippant than normal. It was sort of an interesting thing. I mean, we had a very different sort of month as far as the contributors working with us. And this is a different stable of people than we've had in the past. But we have some repeats. And I sort of was just looking at the poetry in terms of that. And when you look at the anchor interview with F.S. DeBries and the Michelle Hulbeck essay by Jay Gertzman, it's a little darker than our last couple of issues. I mean, the chapbook is definitely both dark and also weirdly flippant.
Yeah, that's what I saw. Is there was a political edge to the whole issue, and there was a morose quality. Maybe that's then. I wasn't sure if it was me or not, but
I don't know. Maybe I wasn't in the best of moods this month. But
do you think the interview with Chuck was a little dark? I don't want to say one way or the other because I conducted it, but I thought maybe less so than the other stuff.
Yeah, I would say so.
Yeah, I don't think it was particularly dark, although it had a kind of maybe slightly darkish undercurrent to it.
Well, yeah, I mean, it was engaging. It was engaging with a few ideas, which were both in defense of science fiction, but also critical of certain things, maybe on my part at least, but yeah, that's probably a little atypical of a typical science fiction interview, I suppose, but who knows.
Definitely think that of the stuff we have, this was the lightest and the maybe the most enjoyable, just kind of on its surface bit we had, because of the poems and the essay, it was pretty dark.
What do you think was the most representative moment of darkness, if you will? Or that's probably too arch. But like, what stands out as like something that makes you think that way?
Well, you know, the interview with Elizabeth Vogel, the line that got to me that I thought was like, maybe what we were dealing with overall was about how HD was a serious poet and her work represented a struggle with nihilism and futility and world shock. And I just thought that struggle was maybe what was going on in the issue. But I'm feeling that in my own day-to-day life too, so...
Well, I mean, you know, it's interesting is that she's in the Pound Elliott group somewhat directly in some instances, somewhat thematically in others. But someone's described T.S. Eliot as like he was cold when he's alive, and now that he's dead, he's colder. The darkness is something they were kind of wading in many respects.
Yeah, I think that's true of like most of the Anglo-High Modernist period, and it's not as true of say maybe the French High Modernist or the Latin American ones, but it's definitely true of the Anglo ones. And I mean, like we're talking about people who wrote the Cantos, which is A, insane, and B, super depressing.
The Wasteland is depressing, though not insane.
Yeah, well, the Cantos isn't all insane, but parts of it are completely, you know, like the treatises on Jeffersonian economics in the middle of a poem that has Chinese in it is pretty crazy. Yeah, I felt like maybe this was the dark undercurrent of high modernism issue. I didn't think that until I put it all together. When I was editing the issue and getting it queued up, I just thought it didn't have some of the humor I try to normally include. But then I also felt like if I had included it this month, it would have felt weird. And it's not that there isn't humor. I mean, that, you know, from Plastic Millennium, which is a much larger work, we just published the poetry segment of the piece by Finn Harbor. Like, there's humor in that. There's even like same song rhyming poetry in that, but yeah. it's dark. I mean,
yeah.
So, although I also felt like it was very rooted in, say, 2004.
Yes,
so,
definitely.
It felt like it was a darkness of a slightly different time. That author has been outside of North America for, I don't know, 15 years. He lives primarily in North Korea now. Not North Korea, South Korea. Should get my Koreas right.
Yes,
should. You're in Korea, because they don't have completely different names in Korea.
Mm-hmm. One is,
anyway.
Yeah, both are dark metaphorically, perhaps. One is also dark physically.
Yes.
Especially at night.
I'm supposed to say, like, one is a wasteland of consumerism, the other is an actual wasteland. And I can say that with some veracity, having seen both. So, you know.
So, outside of the question of our editing selections, which we can come back to later, what do you think may be the source of this sort of darker undertone in the various pieces? So, you know, be it in like Elizabeth Vogel's subject matter is discussing HD, or, you know, in the chapbook, or wherever you might find it, do you think there's sort of disparate, and I mean, obviously they're different kinds of darkness, but do you think there's a unity outside of just the fact that they are dark, or is this a manifestation of, you know, the world in which they were created, composed, all of the above?
I am reluctant to say, because I have such a kind of an obvious opinion that I don't know. I feel that, you know, by being a modernist or neo-modernist journal that tries to engage with the problems of modernity, you're going to end up being this dark, and that it's maybe inevitable. But why this particular issue right now, I'm not so sure.
Well, I mean, one thing is that this issue is smaller because of the relative size of the chapbook. So, you know, the chapbook is like 25 pages if you printed it out roughly. And that eats up, that's roughly equivalent to like what we'd normally have is 5 or 6 different pieces. Now, we're not limited to a page count since we're an e-publication, but I do sort of think about what the person who wanted to sit down and read this all could do. So if they wanted to read, you know, the March issue at one time, what could they feasibly do? And I usually try to think at no more than like 60, 70, maybe 80 pages, if it was all printed out traditionally.
And you were going to consume it in a setting, one sitting, excuse me.
Yeah, I mean, and I know like hardly anyone ever does that. I mean, so, you know, I got that out of the way. It definitely seems like that was my thought on this, and that sort of like limited what we could do. And I felt like the submissions we got were darker, to be honest with you. It seems pretty anxious lately, which we could go into why that is, but I think there's a very modernist turn in the news right now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think a lot of the what I would deem superficial elation of the last, of like 2008, 2010, 2011, it's obviously not so.
What would you say that the source of that elation was in 2008 especially? That seems a little odd to me to think of that year as a year of elation. Was it because of Obama that there was elation? Is that what you're thinking?
Yeah, I'm thinking Obama. I'm thinking people also thought, well, the crash finally came so we can get past it and change all these laws. Remember the whole thing that, you know, you used to hear on liberal radio is never forget to take advantage of a good crisis.
Mm.
And people thought that, you know, the shift was a much larger shift than it was. And I think literarily you saw that too. I mean, like, you think about defining aesthetic of the aughts, which would be McSweeney's.
Mm.
Right?
Yeah.
Which was flippant and political, but, and, you know, very liberal. But it's a time where, like, liberals felt pretty downtrodden and less than earnest and radical idea. You know, the most radical idea you could have would be to talk crap about Halliburton.
You know, it's interesting when you talk about the flippancy. It's no accident that in the interview with SF Debris, his name is Chuck, by the way, I use the SF to talk about it in terms of serious fiction. It seemed to make sense within the context alone of the interview, just given the way we were describing how you taking science fiction seriously and what that means, quote, positively and negatively. But I think that's probably, in terms of modernism, you know, probably a more wide encompassing idea, the desire to take things seriously, not humorlessly, but taking it seriously. I think that's something we repeat fairly regularly. Now, to Doug's point, if you do that, especially given certain contexts, that can get dark very quickly, especially if your context is a general feeling of flippancy or triteness or lack of understanding or a lack of desire to find understanding. You know, so yeah, I mean, that I think if that's probably a theme that, again, to your point earlier, we're sort of asking ourselves to confront. So that was a lot to say, but, you know, it's true. And going back to the whole question of, you know, was, you know, using 2008 as a crisis that you can use, you know, let's also not, you know, let's be frank, you know, having the first black president actually is something substantial. You know, you thought like maybe this could be something, but, you know, when you, you know, what does that mean in the era of McSweeney's? You're absolutely right. I have a feeling at this point, now 6 years into it, I think we're starting to see the diminishing returns.
Yeah, well, I think we're also in the era of M plus one as opposed to McSweeney's.
Yes.
If I was going to define, like, the up-and-coming literary attitude, McSweeney's does not feel like it's the dominant zeitgeist mover anymore. I mean, I still sometimes read McSweeney's website, and I like their press, and their press often does not reflect, you know, Dave Eggers as much as one would think. But I feel like maybe we're in an era of M plus one and a lot of post-Occupy enthusiasm in the literary world, because Occupy was centered in New York and the literary world was centered in New York, and there's no way around the conflation of the two.
Yeah, N plus one became the quote-unquote journal of Occupy. You can judge the degree to which that was a success or failure. You can probably guess where I'm leaning towards.
Do you know, right now, N plus one's website is down, just to let you know. I decided I'd go to it and see what they were doing today, and what they're doing today is crashing, apparently.
Well, I mean, they just released a book, though, where they had, like, Malcolm Gladwell endorse them. If I was a vaguely leftist literary journal, having Malcolm Gladwell endorse me while I was also talking about being a Marxist would probably make me want to slit my wrist.
Well, I mean, and also the way they, you know, they'll make, it does seem light sometimes. Like, they'll make references in their defense to, like, Philip Larkin, which, if anybody knows Philip Larkin, you know, having him as in part of a leftist journal makes absolutely no sense in many ways.
Unless you're a very curmudgeonly leftist.
Which we may very well be.
I mean, I can't see Philip Larkin in the Partisan Review, but if he was in the Partisan Review, he would be more sour than Adorno was. I mean, so, yeah, but it's, you know, and we also live in the era of Vice Publishing and Tao Lin, and in a way, yeah, I'm trying to, you know, like I'm on a one, well, a two or maybe three man crusade against that whole ethos. Former people is like the third camp of literature, except we're not important.
Right. but here's the thing is
the third camp of literature, because I'm not as hostile to the MFA world as I am to a lot of what I see as the dominant trends in New York right now. But, you know, we're agnostic on that too. I think a lot of the MFA world is very insular, and while some of it is good, very little of it seems read outside of itself.
Mm-hmm.
So,
you know, so yeah.
Yeah, Doug, you were about to say something, I think.
Not necessarily. I was just going to say that the flippancy in literature seems to me to be older than, it goes back further than 2008.
For sure.
Yeah, I mean, obviously. But I just don't know. Okay, one thing that I was going to say is when that crisis happened in 2007, 2008, and then especially when, what was it, Lehman Brothers that collapsed?
So people should know, as a consultant and as an econ consultant before that, I'm fairly intimate with knowledge of this. Bear Stearns started going, well, this whole thing started in 2006. When mortgage markets started to show signs of serious problems. Bear Stearns was the first company that had really serious issues to the point where JP Morgan had to buy it in a flash deal orchestrated by the government. Lehman Brothers went a very similar path later in 2008. They tried desperately to save themselves, but, you know, the government tried to make a point of, no, we won't save this one. But when that collapsed, everything went down. The whole parade had stopped. Everybody was struggling to survive. And there was a famous meeting in the JP Morgan boardroom where Jamie Dimon, CEO, still CEO, said, we have to prepare for. And he listed pretty much every bank going to collapse. And when he said we should also prepare for Goldman Sachs not existing, everybody just realized how seriously in deep shit they really were. So with that in context in the financial world, you know how that feeds out to everything else. There you go. It's almost a moment of seriousness interjecting itself. I mean, not right. Almost. It was. So
yeah, definitely. And so when I just remember when Lehman Brothers collapsed, and I've been paying some attention to the other steps that you mentioned before, but not like you were, but I was paying some attention to that. And for me, I actually thought that there was something shady about maybe all of finance, as you know, going back to the Enron scandal. But in any case, when Lehman Brothers collapsed, I felt like it was worse than 9/11, that the day after that happened, you know, I just didn't know what to expect. I mean, I felt it was odd how everything seemed normal. People weren't talking about it the way they had after 9/11. So I was maybe a little odd in my reaction to it. But it definitely seemed quite serious and like finally the other shoe had dropped. So also it undercut whatever optimism might have been coming out of the presidential campaign in the United States anyway, because that all just seemed irrelevant.
Well, I would say that crisis solidified the Obama victory without a doubt. I mean, we make a joke about Sarah Palin, you know, being a dumb shit, and I'll be honest with myself, I think she is. Up until that crisis, she wasn't causing the Republicans to really fail. It was still a pretty decently close race, and then the crisis happened. There's a couple of minor details after that, but it swings completely to Obama. I think there is no doubt after that he is going to become president.
Oh, sure, absolutely. But I just would say that when they had to come together, when McCain and Obama had to come together to shore up both parties and get some consensus so that they could vote through TARP, there was a sense of that the presidential campaign was just not as relevant as what was
going on. Here's an important detail, though, and I think it's big, and I think it also gets to some of the issues we're talking about as to the election and what it means or does not mean. It was McCain who said he wanted to suspend the campaigning to focus on the issue. Obama called bullshit on that and still kept campaigning. That hurt the Republicans, but it also should remind people of a certain cynicism which maintained itself throughout that. So yes, serious for sure, but let us not pretend that the game changed, at least for the team that won. I think that's an important detail to remember.
Suspending the campaign was one thing, but making sure that the vote, because you know, the Republicans in the Congress actually rejected TARP, and then it had to go back. If I'm remembering correctly, the Senate just overrode that vote, and then had to go back, and they had to make sure that everyone voted the right way and got this thing through. And it was both parties that worked to make sure this would happen, and there was an agreement on both sides. Whether or not symbolically one of them suspended the campaign or not was kind of secondary to me. But then we're talking politics, which is weird in a way, but anyway.
No, but it's one of the few times I'll argue for its relevance, because politics here is a reflection of social mood.
Mm-hmm.
And honestly, I think a lot of the reason why we feel, I mean, maybe why the literary anxiety has gotten back up, and maybe this is us talking about ourselves, but I definitely feel like there's a real anxiety out there. I even look at, like, if you look at the genres that are making a big comeback, for example, weird fiction is making a huge comeback right now. That's a genre that thrives on social anxiety.
Absolutely.
It just feels like a lot of people have gone back. Like, people were really cynical in the aughts, but they had some, in the literary world, which is overwhelmingly liberal, let's be honest, some of the best authors may be reactionaries, but the publishing world is overwhelmingly liberal. It is very much the case that they had someone else to blame.
Right.
They don't have that anymore. I mean, some people still try to, but you can't blame, the hypothetical Rust Belt conservative for everything anymore. And I think maybe this gets back to the Plastic Millennium Trap book, because, you know, it's in the title Plastic Millennium, like fake millennium, flippant millennium, and even like the sort of like Korean Zen drawings of fighter planes and Apache helicopters, you know, has a certain like it's making fun of the flippancy of that time. But it's interesting that, you know, someone would feel compelled to write about that now. I mean, we could psychologize Finn Harbor's, you know, being abroad, but I don't think that's really what's going on. I think what's going on is a very keen reflection on the way that anxiety has sort of just been buried. Because most of the problems that animated the United States and maybe the world in 2000, they haven't changed. And they haven't been worked out literarily. They haven't been worked out politically. They haven't been worked out anyway. I mean, like, you know, if anything, the multipolarity of the political situation for the United States is a bigger source of anxiety than it has been since, I don't know, World War I.
Well, you know, it's funny in terms of literature. It's like, you know, the notion, you know, we already knew in the transition into postmodernism that's the quote-unquote big themes already were being shunned to some extent, right? So, I mean, the joke you could go into was that, like, the post-World War II people who were still arguably modern, you know, those top writers wanted to make the great American novel. By the time you get to the 1980s, I don't think anybody has even that pretense to wanting to do that. So that's just one simplified manifestation of it. But so, you know, you tie that into it.
You have the return of the great American novel, but it's a really flippant version of it.
Are you referring to Freedom by Jonathan Franzen?
I'm referring to Freedom by Jonathan Franzen. I'm referring to Infinite Jest. I'm referring to...
Infinite Jest, though, is still 96, so let's be fair on that one.
Well, yeah, but I think a lot of what we see in the aughts pretend was not present in the 90s.
Mm, yeah.
Like... You know, I'm with you. I don't think the 80s are the end of the world. But I do think it's interesting that the anxiety you see about a lot of the, even though it was the Clinton years, a lot of the social formations that you see kind of emerge in 1996.
Mm.
So, I mean, he wrote that in the early 90s, but it seems like, if you want to talk about people blaming everything on the Republicans, and even though they're simultaneously voting for them and stuff like that, you see that as early as 96. You see that after 2 years of Newt Gingrich.
Right. Well, it's funny, additionally, and
4 years of Gingrich.
The Gingrich revolution, quote unquote, happens in 94.
So 2 years, I was right the first time. Even though I was alive, I am now rewriting history.
It's okay. I'm sure the Republicans would like 2 extra years. But what's interesting, and this may be a tangent, I think the other weird manifestation which comes off of that, like you said, the flippancy, or at least or as I say, the abandonment of the grand things, is that the tone is solipsistic to no end. So, like, we had mentioned Freedom being this great American novel, but the real joke of Freedom, in my mind, and I think I discussed this at our very first podcast, is that it opens with a female character who's supposed to be very jockish, yet for whatever reason is writing an autobiographical portion of the book. And you know throughout reading that this is not anybody I believe. This is just Franzen talking with the added little detail of, you should pretend my voice is a woman right now. Well, I don't, Franzen. I never had that experience reading you. I have the experience of reading an angry New York middle-aged man. And that's common throughout. It doesn't matter if you're a New York middle-aged man, a mid-20s something woman in San Francisco, you know, pick your poison. It's all about my immediate position and why people don't understand me, or why I think the world looks weird, even though I don't really ask why it looks weird. I just say it looks weird, and aren't I cute? So you can kind of tell there is darkness in my tone in describing it already. From the position we already talked about.
Yeah, which is why I think Michelle Hulbeck, to bring it back to the theme a bit, is so damn potent right now. He's a modernist. He's been deemed a reactionary and a shit heel and all kinds of things. You know, and he primarily wrote before recently in his last couple of novels, he primarily wrote poetry and an biography of H.P. Lovecraft. In the 90s, he started writing these very, you know, nihilistic books. And he was even taken to court in France for inciting racial hatred. I actually don't read his books as particularly racist. Particularly out of a tradition of French modernists like Céline, who we can talk about that another day. But it's interesting what he critiques. So Hulbeck is, when he talks about, you know, they talk about being a right winger, but he doesn't make sense in an American context because, like, he always talks about the way, like, the market interrupts human relationships and sexuality, and that's what all that sex worker stuff is about. That's what all that, all the darkness in platform and whatever, which whatever has an interesting title in French. The title in French was originally The Extension of the Domain of Struggle.
I like those laconic titles.
He's seen as a conservative, but I don't actually say so because he actually mirrors a lot of Marxist sociologists about what happened to the people after 1968. Which, you know, is like France's grand moment.
Mm-hmm.
I think he's just following darkness throughout. And I think if you look at what's going on right now in letters and what, you know, sort of what we are in the sort of mood of what we're doing and why it seems a little bit darker, is that we are not trying to put any sort of spin on that. Like, we are not trying to make, we're not trying to make our commentary flippant, even though, I mean, like, if you actually read it, there are plenty of flippant stuff we publish.
Mm-hmm.
This issue and any issue, but that's not the only thing we're doing.
What do you think the source of that flippancy is in M plus One or in Freedom or powerlessness?
Powerlessness. There's a certain degree in which, that especially now, given the ages, they're sort of born with it. I mean, honestly, I think that flippancy is partly a product of having baby boomers as your parents. I know that's that brings it way too close to the family that to be to have like a full explanation, but you know that's metaphorically feels right to me. I mean, once you grow up, you know, if you even if you grew up or you were raised by someone who grew up in the 70s, then the you know the me decade, you know this. You know, the beginnings, not the beginnings because it's oh, solipsism always existed, but let's say the prevalence of solipsism beginning that, you know, as a big theme that early, and you grow up in it and you try to escape it, you invariably continue to fall into the sandhill of that. So, what do? You, if you make snarky jokes about certain things, you know, you deal with. It's your way of saying, oh, I can critique it even though I can't do anything about it. But, you know, in critiquing it, I've weakened it. There's a
profound disconnect, I think, because while things are shitty, material culture is too fairly abundant, right? Like, we're in the worst economic crisis since the Depression, but it's hard to imagine anyone, like, boiling shoe butter to eat.
Right.
I mean, so that disconnect, I think, really... You don't know how to react to it.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, probably also baby boomers because, you know, screw them.
Yeah.
And
I mean, and also here's the other thing. I mean, we also exist in a world where by virtue of being so interconnected, you just encounter and have to deal with everybody all the time, regardless of whether or not you're home or you're outside on the street.
Yeah. And also screw them too.
See, I think you're being flippant.
Exactly. what do you do? I mean, like, it's hard. And a certain amount of earnesty after a while in that context seems silly. Unless it's cold earnesty. That's not going to make anyone feel good.
Right.
I might sell books if you're an amazing writer. But then again, like, dark movies don't tend to do well at the box office. Even if they're critically acclaimed.
Well, you know what was funny? This reminded me a little bit after, you know, when we had that run from, like, let's say the very late 60s through the mid to mid-late 70s, we had these runs of very great movies, but they're all very dark, Chinatown arguably being the darkest of them all. You get to the point where Rocky and Star Wars comes up, and if you listen to the audience reaction at the time in, like, you know, news interviews, they said, we've had a lot of dark movies recently. I just wanted to, you know, smile and be happy finally. You can tell in the tone I'm mocking it a little bit, but it's hard to fight that. I mean, that...
I think that was the prevailing ethos of the 80s in a very real way.
Yeah. Yeah, that was definitely what was said at the time, and that's why Reagan won. Was because he offered, the promise of morning in America as opposed to the great malaise that had settled upon America, which was what Carter was pushing as his campaign promise or something.
The malaise comes from after Carter made the famous speech in the aftermath of a number of bad events happening during his presidency where he started criticizing material culture. That's when it was referred to as like, what a great, you know, he's just expressing some general malaise. Why do you want that? You know, you want somebody who can quote unquote make you proud to be who you are and
yeah,
you shouldn't apologize.
He was quoting, if I remember correctly, he quoted a book called The Culture of Narcissism.
Right.
In that speech and, he was some like the president as social critic. It's not what people wanted.
Right. I mean, and remember when my father tells me this, when Carter, you know, during the energy crisis said, like, you know, at the White House, you know, we have the thermostat down a little bit and we're wearing sweaters and we're trying to, you know, economize. You know, my father said it was amazing how many people just said, fuck you and fuck you for telling me to put the temperature down. Like as if he, you know, he ruined every sort of sense of, you know, capability that was America. And now the funny thing is that everybody sort of does it, I think, or that's become more accepted in some ways. So
because prices made you do it anyway.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
I mean, it's funny. People don't like to be told to eat their vegetables, but damn it, if you trick them to eat their vegetables, don't do it.
Or if you say,
I mean,
like,
that's also true with literature. I don't know. I mean, there are days where I have my whole, like, decadence theory of literature, where I think the American public is sub—I am not making friends right now—but is basically subliterate. The only thing they can read anymore is children's literature. But
here's the thing, though, and I agree with you on a lot of fronts, and I do know how this darkness comes in and it manifests itself, and there's, you know, there is, for whatever it becomes, there's honesty to it. But at the same time, and maybe this is where my optimism comes in, I still feel that there is like positive aspects and like joyous aspects that comes from modernist literature in many capacities. And, you know, Nabokov is the primary example. It's like, yes, Nabokov, if you listen to him talk about culture or anything that isn't in art, and even art that he didn't like, to be honest, he is the darkest, harshest person you will ever read talking about anything outside of this. But when he talks about literature that he likes, or literature as such, that is his focus. It's the joy on the aesthetics of the environment.
If I was going to ask everyone to read one book, modernist criticism, other than Northrop Frye, which I suggest everyone read, I just alienated everyone who was not a graduate student in English. But
I've already read it.
I would tell everyone to read Strong Opinions.
Right.
By Nabokov. And then also maybe Borges's...
Nonfiction.
Yeah. Which, if you ever had that triple volume that came out in the late 90s, I think. Was it late 90s? Maybe it was the early
2000s. Yeah, so I have his fiction and the poetry, and I know there was the nonfiction
volume. Yeah, I had all three of them. I actually like the poetry the best, obviously.
Yeah.
And I like the fictions a lot, but I was surprised at how much I liked magazine and philosophical writings, like a whole lot.
I read Labyrinths, but I haven't read the poetry or the nonfiction. How would you characterize Borges's stance critically?
Well, he had a hard time because he was not a left winger in Latin American arts, and that actually, you know, that apparently put you at a distinct disadvantage in getting placements and stuff.
It also may put him at a disadvantage of getting a Nobel Prize.
Yeah. But we all know how, like, after 1950, the Nobel Prize is pretty much a political award.
Right.
Sorry, shouldn't have said that out loud, but how many of the Nobel Prize winners have you heard of in the last 10 years? I've heard of a lot of them, but some of them aren't even that easily read in English at all. So.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I think the last...
So what was his politics?
He was, I would say, ultimately, he was very much
an old liberal.
Yeah, or an old liberal, and Nabokov is this way too, but they're old liberals who, in an American context, are read as conservative. Not for lack of, not just completely nonsensically, I mean, it sort of makes sense why you would have that, but they are classical liberals in many regards.
Yeah, classical liberals, yeah.
Actually, the other trouble that Borges got is when shit was happening in Argentina, his home country, he chose to remain silent on it, and there were leftists who were said, why aren't you politically engaged? You're just living in your own aesthetic world. He wouldn't have any part of it, and he also thought very little of many left-wing movements as such. And he even Christopher Hitchens actually writes about this when he went to Borges' home and read to him, and he was a little joking actually about. He said, "Oh, you're going to Chile? You should say hello to that nice gentleman, Mr. Pinochet." I mean, he was doing it as a light joke, but many people read that as him being a serious pro, you know, fascist or some stupid, you know, logic or whatever that often gets thrown around. But that actually raises a good question with Borges, because he definitely lived in an aesthetic world, and there was a lot of joy out of that. And you, even in his, you know, magazine works, you know, he expresses a lot of very joyous encounters with art or the aesthetics. And so that's an interesting thing. Also related to us, at least the mantle I pick up, maybe more so than the rest of us, is I place the aesthetics in central import. But I know that when you do that, people will tend to say, oh, either you're living in an aesthetic world isolated from everything else, or you're, you know, people don't even understand you anymore. people don't even understand the notion of aesthetics, other than aesthetics is just what you like, period. And it's like there's a little bit more meat to it than that,
I guess.
You know, I think there is.
I mean, I'm not going to get on an argument about aesthetics because I find aesthetics fascinatingly interesting, but also incredibly historical. Like, if you look at any period of time, it's hard to actually say what the best art is, because what's canonized might be reflecting an aesthetic of a later time, but sometimes actually, like in the British canon more than the American. You have what's popular, like, not in your current epoch, but the very next one. So, for example, in the Restoration, you get, like, Alexander Pope and all this stuff canonized. You go back and read that now, I dare you to go back and read Turning of the Screw.
You mean Rape of the Lock.
Rape of the Lock. What is it? No, there's a Screw one, too.
No, the Turn of the Screw is Henry James.
No, that's Henry James. There's a Screw joke. Anyway, but the Rape of the Lock are... Essays on Man, and tell me that you actually like that. I mean,
I won't give you my answer because I know you won't like it, but yeah, I'll give you that.
Yeah, I mean, like, it's and then there's like epochs that are weirdly like read modernly, even though they're earlier. Elizabethan stuff reads pretty modern, whereas like Edwardian stuff, even though it's like almost contemporary in some ways, it's not even, it's like barely pre-modern. Reads like it's a million years ago.
Well, I would say to counter that, I would say Howard Zinn still holds up. Even though he's not he's like, even though he's on the cusp between Victorianism and Edwardianism, Thomas Hardy feels the most contemporary.
True, but like Jane Austen, for example.
Oh well, that's Regency period.
That's Regency.
Yeah.
Excuse me. But still, like that's. That's early modern, right?
Yeah, there's beginnings of it in her works for sure. But that is true. I mean,
older than some Shakespeare does.
Yeah, that's fair. I'll grant you that.
Or read like Ben Jonson as opposed to Shakespeare. maybe that's just because Shakespeare, and maybe because we read Shakespeare off so much, he feels contemporary. But, you know, like, I think you do see it more in the British canon. The American canon is more interesting in that it kind of reflects the early 20th century, because that's when we started English departments.
Mm-hmm.
And so, like, everybody loves Melville, because Melville.
Well, we remember about Melville, what's interesting and supports your point, is that for the longest time, nobody thought very well of Melville outside of a small group of people. But then he was rediscovered, I think, in the 20s.
Right,
and he's been secure
and
ever since.
Moby Dick was a great American novel, which
I think it merits the case. I will give it that. It merits.
Yeah,
the
but it's not. It's not. It's a great American novel in and only in the sense that like any great American novel basically is shit talking about America.
Well, yeah,
because like that's kind of what the great American novel does. I mean, that's not unique to like Franzen. I mean, can you think of like the like. Positive Portrait of America, great American novel.
No,
but
well, it depends. It depends on how you read Augie March.
So you got two. You got Gone with the Wind and Augie March. That's it.
Well, Augie March is both. It's critical and it's positive. So Gatsby is the same way, but you don't like Gatsby. I know. We'll have this fight later.
I don't hate Gatsby.
Gatsby's critical. Come on.
Gatsby's almost entirely
Gatsby
critical.
Is both. You remember what I said, it's both. Gatsby is critical of Jay Gatsby, but Jay Gatsby in his self-construction also manifests the possibility of America. That's why it's a great American novel, because it's both are contradictory and essential to each other.
Okay, I'm going to go off on this.
Well, but okay. So,
I feel like I'm waiting Howard Bloom again.
Well, so why... So that's, I think that's interesting that Gatsby is both. And do you think that maybe Melville's both, or that
yes,
I think Melville is a lot more, maybe a little bit, but there's so little hope in Melville.
Well, Melville is it's almost as if to call it a great American novel, while true, feels insufficient because of the it's dealing with in the Burkean sense with the sublime, which to construct it within the confines of a nation feels insufficient.
which is like the Sublime and how the Sublime's going to kick your ass.
Yes.
And not necessarily in a good way. Although there is interesting Americanisms, because I was reading a book recently that was talking about like specific preachers that actually we've actually found out who they were that are kind of vaguely referenced in that book.
Right, and Ahab is clearly modeled in part, at least, on Andrew Jackson.
Right, I mean, Ahab's Andrew Jackson. There's a specific preacher who that sea preacher is based on. I can't remember.
I can't either, but I know who you're talking about.
And stuff like that. And I think like everything but the Andrew Jackson model was completely lost to most of the early readers of Melville. Because they were reading it in a 1920s context, and like they weren't even thinking about it having any contemporary relevancy to what Melville was writing. You know, it's also like when people read Hawthorne as some cow representative of Puritan literature.
Well, he was a critic of Puritanism.
Well, yeah, but he's also like 100 years removed.
Well, absolutely, yeah. People think it was contemporary. People think it was somehow written by a contemporary. I hear you. I mean, not everybody, but. Yeah, that I've had that encounter.
It was taught in several high schools that I've encountered as Puritan literature. I mean, they may have known it wasn't, but they taught it in the unit to kids as if it was. And I was just like, what are you doing? I mean, I know Puritan literature is boring, but what are you doing?
It's
interesting how this issue of Foreign People is making us kind of be historical in the way we talk about literature, and you know, we were talking about politics in a historical way just a moment before.
The exception of the sci-fi interview, which we should talk about a bit and go back to it because that builds up to one of our future issue projects, is that I feel like most of this was sort of historically based. I mean, the chat book is very much based in kind of mentally going back through the 80s. And, you know, 90s and early 2000s and, like, the political discourse of that time. But doing it in a very sing-songy poetry way.
Right. I like that aspect of it. It kind of...
I think if that hadn't been written in nursery rhyme verse, it would have been unbearable.
Right. Yeah.
It's like, oh, God, it's another drone thing. Except we're not even to drone time. Proto-drone.
Right.
Yeah, but what's interesting, because I also was going to bring it back to the SF issue. I'm looking back on it, and you know, there is a certain historical quality to some of the questions. Some more limited and recent than others. But like, you know, so I'll start with the lighter one. I did like how we talked about the change of the sci-fi channel, and how like, you know, for whatever it was at one point in the 90s, it's now known for producing a movie called Sharknado.
Yeah. And Sharktopus and Sharky. You know what's interesting about those movies is originally sci-fi movies before they became SYFY, they were sci-fi movies that were made by other companies but were so bad they wouldn't release them even straight to video, so they just sell them to sci-fi.
Well, the Sci-Fi Channel did do you know, it did attempt at least to some bigger works. So, for example, the sci-fi attempt to do not just Dune, but, you know, the Children of Dune and the Messiah of Dune at the same time.
They do good miniseries. Yeah. That was actually a separate thing, which is interesting because they actually do good mini. Alice is another one.
Battlestar Galactica, which is still, you know, outside of certain quibbles about the ending, still a fantastic retelling of that story. But, you know, it's funny. I did like the line where he has, like, you know, when was the last time someone said the problem with this new sci-fi movie was that it was just too highbrow for me? Or I failed to understand the symbolism of the giant queen spider eating a helicopter. You know.
I mean, well, I think of it about the time of the age of the high concept sci-fi movie. What's the most recent one? Probably Moon, right? Wouldn't you say? Moon are
trying to think.
That's 2009, I think.
Or when was District 9? Same year, I think, right? 2009?
Yeah, like the same year. Yeah, those are your two high concept, and they're both low budget. I mean, District 9 doesn't look low budget, but it was. for a sci-fi movie particularly.
Yeah.
I mean, I feel like the sci-fi milieu, as far as like media, is dominated by Joss Whedon, who, while not unserious, is not particularly serious. And perhaps his seriousness is slightly overstated by his fans.
Derek, you and I have had this conversation in specific to Firefly, but I have, it's more general, my opinion of Joss Whedon is that I really can't get into him. I mean, I've encountered a number of his works, from Buffy through his Alien film to Firefly, and it's not interesting to me. I see why people think it is interesting, and I don't think they're being unreasonable to call it interesting.
I think Firefly interesting, and that's it. Maybe because I'm Southern, but
yeah. But what's good is, like, we were talking about in that interview, you know, there are a couple of moments when sci-fi kind of blossomed more into like a mainstream, or if not mainstream, at least some sort of literary respectability. You know, we talk about the 60s and 70s, and then we talk about recently, about like, what is that, you know, how it's sort of reflective. So obviously we talk about the 60s and 70s notion of counterculture or doing something a little askew. And so you get, you know, like Robert Heinlein's books coming into attention, or at least one of them, because Heinlein is not a flower child by any stretch of the imagination.
Yeah, he's actually weird. Like,
he's a libertarian, but of like a weird sort of
realistic variety.
Yeah, exactly.
And like Starship Troopers for him was not satire.
No, Paul. I mean, that, I love that misreading. I think that's one of the most enjoyable misreadings to have gotten Paul Verhoeven's movie. But I do stress that it is a misreading of the book, because it's not a pro-fascist book by any stretch of the term, nor satirically so either.
But it's not satirical. It's something else completely, actually. But you know, kicking Heinlein now seems a little bit weird. There's been plenty of critics to do that. In fact, I think he's almost buried from the canon now, except for Stranger in a Strange Land. I don't think anyone talks about him anymore. Am I wrong about that? Doug, this is your specialty.
I don't know. When I went to Clarion in 95, people were still fans of Heinlein. I mean, maybe Stranger in a Strange Land came up the most. I wasn't a big fan at that time. I've read Stranger in a Strange Land and some of his short fiction. There's no getting around the fact that he was just really significant for putting forward, you know, the tropes of science fiction. And I think he's still admired for that, you know.
I think like Philip K. Dick, though, is now sort of eclipsed him as
he'd
eclipsed him back then too, I don't know.
Maybe it's where I live, but I felt like more people knew Heinlein when I was growing up in the 80s than Philip K. Dick.
Well, it's funny because Philip K. Dick not only superseded Heinlein, but he feels like he superseded Asimov. He superseded Ray Bradbury, even though they're all doing their own different things. I mean, like Philip K. Right. Dick sort of won that generational battle.
But he's like Melville, you know, in so much as he's not an optimistic writer, and he's critical of the very genre he's in. Not on purpose exactly, but by a quirk of his personality and experiences, he's not really the kind of humanist progressive that even Heinlein is as a libertarian.
And he also wasn't a technological fetishist either.
Oh, not at all.
No, well, you get, he definitely feels like when you read J.G. Ballard and you're like, yeah, I see how this is related.
Absolutely.
Or when you read, I'm trying to think of who else from that new wave. Anyone know him, John Harrison?
Yeah.
You definitely feel a relationship there.
Oh, yeah. Between Ballard and M. John Harrison?
Yeah, and also both of them and Philip K. Dick.
I mean, it's really hard to compare Ballard and M. John Harrison to Philip K. Dick, because Ballard and M. John Harrison were so much more, the tone of their work and the prose in their work was so so much closer to literature than Dick was. And it, so Dick had all the trappings of the of pulp writing, and the, these guys were creating moods and making you kind of...
But you feel like without Philip K. Dick, none of that would have happened. Like, I don't think that... not that it wouldn't have happened somewhere. I don't think it would have happened in sci-fi.
I think you have to look to Michael Moorcock and Harlan Ellison and those guys to and the people who were kind of
Ellison deserves a lot of credit in part for his Dangerous Vision books, which edited together a lot of these pieces. And in fact, did you hear about actually the there was a little bit of a schism between Ellison and J.G. Ballard on the book which Ballard was in?
Yeah, I've heard about that. I've forgotten the details of it. But so yeah, it's so old news. But yeah, go ahead.
So yeah, so it's so Ballard's. I forgot which of Ballard's stories was in Dangerous Visions. But Ballard really wanted the assassination of Kennedy told as a downhill motor race, and anybody who's read that story realized how strong that is. I mean, they did pick a good story, but it wasn't iconic as that one. And I guess the story goes, there was a miscommunication or something, and Ellison didn't publish that. I think there was an interlocutor between them, like a sub-editor or a publisher who said, like, took one look at Kennedy as a downhill motor race and said, no way in fucking hell, or hit it or something. And Ballard always thought that Ellison didn't have the courage of his own convictions of Dangerous Visions. He said they weren't dangerous enough.
I always feel like when you look at that type, I'm going to continue singing praises of Philip K. Dick. And yes, we can talk about,
you know, it's weird for me not to be the one who's like pushing that you're right. I mean, I want to side with you because he's the most influential writer for me.
But if you don't have him writing what he's writing in the 50s, I don't think you would have had the space, even for maybe Ellison, in the same way. Maybe I'm misreading it because Ellison, you know, is coming out of, you know, writing for Twilight Zone, right?
Mm-hmm. No. Ellison wrote wrote two episodes of The Outer Limits, which were pinched by James Cameron.
I knew he wrote some of an anthology show.
Yeah, he did. He wrote it a couple of places, actually. But
he wrote for Star Trek, too, didn't he?
The City on the Edge of Forever.
It's one of my favorite episodes of Star Trek.
But the history behind that is also very interesting, which is, short answer is, like, even Ellison's version is darker and better than the one you actually got, which is good in and of itself.
Yeah.
So I can't see, like, Gene Roddenberry, even if he had anything at all to do with it. Like, so, condoning Ellison version,
look, I want to say something about J.G. Ballard and Alfred Jarry and the Crucifixion considered as an uphill bicycle race, just kind of as a side note here, that maybe, like, I think that you got to look to the fact that these guys who were in the British New Wave were looking to the early 20th century and the avant-garde as much more than they were to Philip K. Dick to kind of inform what they were going to be doing. I mean, they were his contemporaries, really. And so Philip K. Dick was this kind of sui generis mystic who became very important later, maybe in the 90s. But I don't think he was the reason that guys like Ballard could do what they were doing. I just don't.
No, I'm actually with Doug on this one. I don't want to diminish Dick's importance.
Right. I mean,
regardless, though. The other interesting thing that the new wave science fiction also manifests, which came out in the interview, is that there's kind of different. There's obviously different camps in sci-fi, like everything. But you know, at the time, you know, and also what sets Dick apart from his American equivalents is that Dick is not, as I said, a technology fetishist, or he's not a hard SF kind of guy. And you know, I think what tends to happen is that there's a certain degree to which fans of any genre fetishize certain details. And so I use hard SF as my go-to example, because what is hard SF if not, you know, an emphasis on, well, no, this technology has to work this way. And, you know, you need this detail, right? I mean, people really, forgive the expression, get off on that. And it's a question of what do we, you know, is that, you know, what do we make of that? Especially when I would argue that the artists or the writers in sci-fi that last with us longer, and, you know, and I'm willing to have someone disagree with me on that. I don't worry about that. Are these guys who are doing something above and beyond the genre per se? So it's like Ballard is one example. Dick is another. Like Dick, I think sort of saw
them. The name in the room we haven't brought up.
Yeah.
That's like, also that's like, if I wanted to actually say like what made New Wave sci-fi see have an era or of legitimacy outside of Britain, you kind of have to have Vonnegut.
Yeah,
absolutely.
But he, you know, he never claimed that.
No, no, Vonnegut, I think, did
Vonnegut
think of himself as a science fiction.
He dropped it like a rock.
Right. I mean, he, but as soon as he became, you know, a professor at the Iowa's Writers Workshop and Slaughter House 5 was a gigantic success, he did not want to claim being a science fiction writer anymore.
Yeah, whatever. Same thing with Margaret Atwood.
And Ballard, too. Like
speculative fiction to make everyone feel better.
Yeah, but the thing about, okay, what about Ray Bradbury? Or Ursula Le Guin, for that matter.
It's all interesting in that, like, it's hard.
That's hard, SF. None of it is.
Yeah, none of it is, and it's all good.
Bradbury took himself an SF writer, period. And not in the snooty way.
No, he was a fantasist, is what he called
it. Yeah, he actually said he didn't actually fit the mode of the genre. Right. He was a different genre. And if you read, I actually tend to agree with him. Like, he's not even a new wave writer. He's a literary fantasist.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I think of a lot of his best short stories. They're not sci-fi at all, even if they're set on Mars. Right. It's like calling Howard.
I know
Howard
who you're. Waldrop? No. He's talking about the Conan the Barbarian.
Oh.
It's like calling Robert E. Howard because of some books.
A sci-fi writer.
Or a weird writer.
Not William Burroughs, the earlier Burroughs.
Edgar Rice Burroughs.
It's like calling him I don't really consider him a sci-fi writer.
Guy, you know, about. This conversation is so depressing to me, because you guys talk about Melville and Nabokov, and I'm like, oh yeah, I read a little bit of Melville, haven't read Nabokov. You talk about these pulp writers, like, yeah, oh yeah, I got an opinion on all of them.
Well, you know, here's what's interesting, though, because like, this actually does go back to another thing that came up in the interview, which also gets to sort of how the darkness sort of manifests itself in sci-fi, and it's how critics approach this. And I think this is an internet phenomenon, so forgive me if this feels like a little bit of insider baseball, but I think enough people have encountered online reviewers, hence why you're listening to us, of like how they respond particularly to sci-fi in general, because that's, they have the biggest audience of critics. And what you tend to see online, and it's related to this issue of what you fetishize, when people are critiquing something, you know, it's usually like as I jokingly say, it's spot the plot hole game. You know, it's like, oh, you know, if the warp engines, you know, went up to factor 2, but it only can go up to 2.5, it's wrong, blah blah blah, I do not like this, I'm cold, you know, and all that kind of thing. You know, in a way, what it says to me, even though, like, you know, I think there are reasons why, you know, you would have legitimate critiques along those lines. There is a tendency in which I feel like people in their criticism aren't willing to ask themselves the harder questions of the work. And I think Chuck does. So SF Debris does do this. Mm-hmm. And what's interesting to me, and it again relates to at least my own sense of why I get sometimes discouraged, is that, you know, it's to make those harder and harder critiques. Seems like something that people either are not willing to do or incapable of doing or too afraid of doing. I don't know why. Are they afraid of alienating people?
If they could do it in a political manner. The political call out of sci-fi is like,
oh God, don't even get me started.
Yeah, I'm sorry to say, I don't want to get you started. I know it's been a sore point for you lately, Doug.
Yeah, yeah.
But, I mean, like, I say that because it's easy. It's easy to do. Even when it's legitimate, it's easy. What was Larry Niven's, it seems to be everybody's hating on right now. I was reading something by Scalzi hating on him. But everybody's hating on Larry Niven's. And everybody hates on Heinlein, right, for being a sexist.
Yeah.
Which he may well have been.
Yeah. No, he probably, yeah, I mean, it was a lot of things.
That he was. There's some pretty, what was it in The Number of the Beast? There's like, something he says where man should have never taught women to speak or something.
Right.
Yeah, it's pretty extreme.
I was like 12 years old and laughed, but also thought, like, man, that's wrong.
Well, first of all, it's wrong because that's not what happened.
probably the other way around.
Yeah, most likely. And I mean, not. I mean, obviously, both genders probably language emerged simultaneously. But if you're going to look to like the development of the brain as an example, women have more of a facility for language than men seem to. And so, it's a bunch of crap. But on the other hand, now you can please edit this out. But on the other hand, if you've been married or had a bad relationship with a woman, I can understand the sentiment.
Well, here's what's
being a bad relationship. Oh, that's a slip. But I mean, any marriage has ups and downs. Is all I'm saying. And so.
Well, it's what you raise is an interesting question, which is that how do we read and why? I think it's the easy way of let's say reading into Heinlein and said, like, yes, he's clearly a sexist at some or in certain points. You can't. I mean, it's easy to see it. But yeah. do you end the reading there? And say, you know, that's it, nothing can be learned? Or do you try to read deeper into that? It's like, so why is he thinking this way? How is his manifestation of that sense of anger or woundedness revealing in the text? You know, what does that holistic approach teach you? And I feel like that's a task which, it's frankly, takes more work than the other way around. And I don't know if it's, again, a question of people just no, it takes work and they're not willing to do it, or they don't even know how to do that. And I think both ways are possibly true. And it's that, again, going back to the darkness, that's kind of a depressing state of affairs to have to encounter.
Yeah, I mean, like, don't get me wrong. I am all about calling people out for being actual sexist shits or whatever in the proper context, particularly in literature.
Well, what do you think about Philip Roth on that front?
Philip Roth to me is a very interesting case. I do like him, and he arguably, and people do think of him, David Foster Wallace, as a solipsistic, you know, misogynist and everything. And there are many ways where that's true. But at the same time, I think somewhat intentionally, on his part, but more important than his intention, I would say the way I read him is that that is step one of Philip Roth. I mean, once you get, okay, his character is a solipsistic and they, you know, they're worried about being virile and everything. That's part one. Now, where do you go? You know,
right.
And his books, you know, have, I would say, if you read them correctly, have at least like a dozen steps. They're, you know, they're building off of substantial commentary or thoughts or explanation of his world. And if you just limit yourself to saying, oh, you know, this, that, or the other, you know, you're selling yourself short as well as selling him short. And more importantly, you're selling yourself short. I mean, he's doing well enough to where it doesn't really matter what you think. what you think should matter at least to yourself.
Well, the last Philip Roth novel I read was A Dying Animal, which is...
Yeah, it's the follow-up to the Kepish novels. The first encounter with Kepish is The Breast, where it was a satire a parody.
I've read The Breast, and I've read, I don't know if I read The Professor of Desire, but I read The Breast. I mean, that was,
it's like Kafka, like Kafka's, you know, Metamorphosis, you know, Gregor Zamza waking up to see.
It was kind of silly in a way, but the fact that he managed to pull it off was a pretty amazing feat, The Breast. But the Dying Animal, which is, if I remember correctly, his ex-girlfriend turns up and she's, you know, they started dating when she was sleeping together, not dating, when he was a professor and she was a student, and now she's in her 30s or older, and she's got cancer, and he doesn't take her in. He basically just, you know, for out of self-interest, puts up a barrier to her and doesn't do right by her. Is what I remember about the book, and I felt that it was that the immorality of that character. I didn't judge the book based on that immorality, but I felt that it was I felt the author was trying to justify the immorality of the character.
I can see why you would have that reading. I don't. If anything, I thought, no, this is really bad. I mean, if Philip Roth, you know, can even, you know, is really depicting Kepish in a very bleak, dark, unsympathetic way. I mean, not entirely unsympathetic. I mean, I think I think Philip Roth is, rather than call it sympathy, I would say it's understanding why he is this way. But at the end of the day, I don't think I did not walk away from The Dying Animal thinking that, oh, David Kepes was in the right, that cancer-ridden woman should have just left him alone. It's like, no, I mean, he had many things worthy of criticism.
I think you can see that in any of a lot of the male novelists of that time period, from the 70s particularly. I think it is wrong to excuse that, but I also think you're right that it's a completely unnuanced reading to only see that. I think if you deal with male subjects and maleness honestly, I can think of, you know, let's talk about, like, the one thing I saw Nathan Bulligan really accused of, for example, a writer that we have an interview coming out with, not this month, but soon, and whatnot, plug for the future. Mm-hmm. But in all seriousness, I read someone who condemned him for being sexist towards his characters. Mm-hmm. But he's writing about lower middle class Southern men.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, there is one. Sorry,
like,
go ahead.
Post-feminist, like, even post-feminist, but, like, third-wave feminist, I wouldn't have believed it for a moment.
Oh, wow. Well, the first story in North American Lake Monsters, you know, it's about, it's about a few things, but I may be giving away the ending, so spoiler alert, spoiler alert, spoiler alert. Okay, now that you've been placated, it's a story of how a woman comes to abandon her child.
Yeah.
And there's ways of reading that in which, you know, oh, he's angry at women. And I think, again, related to your point, I think that's a very superficial reading of the story.
Yeah, well, but look at the way men treat women. You're right. But the rest of the book's about the way men, including boys, treat women.
Right.
And usually to their own destruction. Although there is one unsympathetic, there's another unsympathetic female Nazi character.
Right.
But people exist.
They do. It's true. Yeah.
I am poor. I am from poor. I know those people from a poor Southern background. Those people very much exist. They are very real. And I thought he was very fair about it, rendering their inner life. I haven't read a whole lot of accusations of him being super sexist, but I have read a couple. A lot of people caught on that he's just trying to be honest with the characters, but not everybody did. But, I mean, if you look at the consequences for those men for the way they treat women, even in the case of the female Nazi, who you actually end up sympathetic for once you find out what's going on with her,
mm-hmm.
you don't get the feeling that he has a very negative view of women at all. If anything, he might have a negative view of men, but he's writing about it as honestly to those characters as he possibly can. And I feel that's true in Roth, too. I don't think it excuses it all. I think some of Roth's real, you know, turmoil is in there, for real. I don't think you can say that it's not.
Right. I mean, there are definitely reasons why you would read it autobiographically, not the least of which that he has several books in which Philip Roth is a character.
Right. Although I tend to think that that's always a trick.
It is. It's intentionally a trick.
Going to be autobiographical. It's not going to be in the books where you're actually calling yourself by your name. If you think about, like, the things they carried, some of the most unautobiographical stories in that book are the ones.
Well, Operation Shylock is the biggest joke on that.
Look, I think you just have to look at Philip Roth's whole trajectory
It's not unproblematic. I mean, if you look at The Plot Against America, you can't say that's a non-problematic book.
Right. No, I think it's a horrible book, actually, but leading aside. Go ahead, Doug. I'm sorry.
Yeah, I was going to say, he has his a very legitimate starting point, and there's misogyny in the books early on, okay? Or there's a kind of misogyny in the books all the way through. But it isn't an endorsed misogyny misogyny is not critically examined. It's something that's being worked through. I don't think that Roth solved the problems that he put forward for himself very well. I think he ended up in some dead ends towards the end of his, as we're coming up towards the end of his career. But I don't think you can say that his problem was primarily that he didn't treat the women characters well enough. If he had really decided, well, I'm going to make sure to be correct and write women characters so that they're strong and you know, redeemable and always just, and
but how is that not like magical
heroism? Right, well, always put them in the right light. Well, first of all, you're right. You'd be criticized for putting them up on a pedestal, and it would still be misogyny. And secondly, it just wouldn't be true to...
So, too, to be completely
right,
fair.
Yeah, no, right. So truth is, we're writing in a world where sexism exists and the relationship between the sexes is really filled with landmines and... That no matter who you are, no matter how moral you are, you're gonna end up stumbling. So you're gonna stumble in your work. It's just gonna happen. Yeah, that's gonna happen. The question is, how well do you deal with the stumbling, and how willing are you to go back on your own ideas and start over again? I think because I think that didn't happen the way it might have been. Useful for it too, for Roth.
Well, that's again goes back to the importance of again taking work seriously and again fighting against this idea of flippancy. I think it's fairly easy nowadays to encounter these subjects in a very superficial way with a lot of name calling, or if you will, like you know these empty gestures, and everybody just completely continues to deteriorate into, you know, whatever nonsense. On both sides, or you can do, and this is where I'll be the idealist in terms of art. You know, the way in which art works best theoretically, and you know, there are many ways of reading it. It provides you the vehicle in which the ordinary discourses of everyday life are clearly insufficient. And so, if you consider yourself someone interested in the arts, might I suggest that you know taking that serious approach to the work is definitely more beneficial than something that we have hitherto been categorizing as flippancy.
If you're going to be flippant in a serious manner.
Yeah.
I mean, like, I think that's why we can't hate David Foster Wallace. It's the same way we hate Jonathan Franzen, who seems like a cheap David Foster Wallace. There, I said it.
No, I totally agree. That's why I say, for me, David Foster Wallace is a bête noir, as opposed to Jonathan Franzen, who I just hate.
Right, I mean, like, David Foster Wallace, you feel like he took his flippancy seriously, it came from a real place. And maybe, you know, Francis comes from a real place too, but it's just not a place I'm particularly interested in, and it's very New York-y.
Well, and also Wallace, for whatever you want to say about him, I think desperately fought to get out of his solipsistic circle, but failed in a very dramatic way.
I usually don't take someone's work in life as...
Yes, obviously his personal life, but I even mean it in the work. I think.
No, yeah. Well, Oblivion is like when you read Oblivion, you think, man, this guy's going to commit suicide, and I thought that was an affectation of the story. I didn't think it was for real. So you know, sadness as it is, although he's been gone a while now. Yeah,
in 2008, a little bit of serendipity to the magic year we're talking about.